In the drawing along, there's going to be some things that you need. First, a pencil. If you want to get fancy, Laura says you can have a hard pencil and a soft pencil. She's holding them up, as you can see there. Yep, that's what you need. And so she gives an example, HB and 4B, if you have those around. But a regular pencil works too. That's what Scott and I will be using. Paper, a couple of sheets would be perfect. And then also a ruler or a straight edge. So go get your materials. Go, go, go. This will be a lot of fun. We'll be back in just a few seconds with the program, and we'll get started then. Again, pencil, paper, and a ruler. See you soon. Okay. Does everybody have their stuff? Make sure to get it. And David and Nikki, you might have to unmute yourself on your end. Since we'll start off with you guys, you can start by unmuting and we'll get started over on the Facebook. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Houston Oasis. We are glad to have you join us this morning. We have a very fun morning planned for you. Houston Oasis meets every week here in Houston, Texas. We are a secular community. We've got great talks. Today, we're going to have a great opportunity for you to participate in a drawing lesson. But one of the ways that we kick off every week, and it's the way we're going to kick off this week, is with great music. And we're excited to welcome back David Dietz. Cellist David Dietz has performed across the U.S. and Europe and is equally comfortable in solo, chamber, and orchestral settings. Currently residing in Houston, Texas, David is pursuing a master's degree at Rice University's Shepherd School of Music under the tutelage of Desmond Hobig. And today he's also joined by Nikki Cohn on the piano. Houston Oasis, please welcome David Dietz and Nikki Cohn.
Hi, good morning. It's really great to be back. I played here a couple times over the past year. So great to see you all in this format. Nikki and I are both classical musicians by trade, but actually we're both huge fans of jazz. So we thought for this, you know, fun setting, we would play a couple of our favorite jazz standards to start. We're going to play a little bit of classical music at the end, but we're going to start with two jazz classics. The first one is called It Could Happen to You. And then after that, we're going to play a tune called Misty. So thank you. Hope you enjoy it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you guys so much. Excellent. Lots of jazz hands and applause on our social media and here in the Zoom. We appreciate you guys playing for us. And we'll have some time to hear more from David and Nikki a little bit later in our program this morning. But for right now, we are going to move on to an exciting activity, something I'm very excited about. Scott has come along to join.
Hey guys, they will let anybody in now.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. He's come along to join today too, because he heard about what we're doing and he's pumped. And I guarantee you his drawing is going to look better to my, than mine. But our title is Quick Draw, The Basics of How to Draw a Photo by our speaker, Laura Spector. Laura Spector is a fellow of the New York Foundation for the Arts, a recipient of an individual grant award from the Houston Arts Alliance, and artist-in-residence recipient of the Joan Mitchell Foundation. She has a number of exhibitions to her name. Her artwork can be seen in collections around the world, and she's currently teaching courses online via her own studio, the Glasscock School for Continuing Studies at Rice University and Art League Houston. You could check her out at laurasspector.com, but for right now, we're excited to welcome her to Houston Oasis. Let's welcome Laura Spector.
Hi, good morning, everybody. This is it's a pleasure to be here, and it's early for me. I'm a nighttime teacher usually, so I'm waking up with you. I'm going to thank you for that nice introduction. I'm going to share some content with you so we can get right on into this. I am guessing that a lot of you have not had art instruction before. Maybe some of you have. But I'm just going to go through real quick like and share some information with you. So again, this is Quick Draw, and it's just an introduction, a really basic introduction to one approach to drawing. There are multiple approaches to drawing. This is one of them. We're going to be working with the grid today. And this is what I've got outlined for, and we have a short amount of time, so we'll get right to it. So I'm going to go over just our drawing tools, which pencils, papers, and erasers. And this is for any of you who are interested in continuing to draw after this presentation, if you want to pick it up as a hobby, something to do while you're quarantining. I'm going to talk about the value scale, which is the most important aspect of all art across the board, whether you're drawing or painting. Light perspective sphere. This is to make your work look a little bit more organized and a little more realistic. And then I'll talk a little bit about how to choose a good photo to draw from. And then we'll talk about how to organize a grid, and then we'll get started with drawing. So first of all, this is a photo that I took of my toolbox, and I have Les the Sander. You'll notice in here that I've got some really sharp, sharp points on some of my pencils at the end of the row on the right-hand side. Those points are cut down. They're hard pencils, so I can cut them down with my X-Acto blade, which is on the left-hand side. I noticed I don't have a little, one thing I didn't check this morning is to see if I could draw on my screen. Doesn't look like I can, but that's okay. I'll try and be really careful with how I explain things. So the pencils on the right are shaved down with an X-Acto blade to get that really long point. And then I use a sander to sand them down to sharp points. So that way, when I'm drawing out kind of the architecture with my pencil, I can see the paper rather than looking at a chunk of wood. So it just makes drawing a little easier if you're drawing vertically, if you're drawing on an easel, but it's not necessary. There are plenty of amazing drawings that are done with just nubs of pencils, and they're done on napkins. So that is helpful to know. These are a variety of pencils, all different hardnesses. And there's erasers. I've got a vinyl eraser, which is that blue thing. It's retractable. And then at the top, that yellow eraser, that's an eraser. It's called a kneadable eraser. And it comes out and it's kind of like chewing gum. You pull it apart. And that yellow eraser is good for like picking up extra graphite. I like to think of erasers not as tools of correction to fix things, but instead you can use them to draw. So you could go back into your drawing and draw with them. That one that's called Vanish is a new eraser that I recently discovered. I don't know how new the actual product is, but it's a 4-in-1 eraser. So it's really helpful to have that in case other erasers are not effective. That's a good one to use. Any eraser will do though. Graphite pencils are made of graphite, even though we often refer to them as lead. And the two brands that I have on the left, Stettler is my favorite. They're made in Germany. The reason why they're my favorite is because they have very low breakage within the pencil itself. So they're the blue pencils that you'll see me using. And by low breakage, that means as you're sharpening them, I don't know if you've ever experienced the frustration of sharpening to a sharp point, and then you get ready to draw and it just breaks. And then you got to start sharpening your pencil again. Stettler pencils are made in a way that they really have very low breakage points. So you can sharpen them really super sharp, and they just won't break on you as easy. Blackwing is kind of a fun, trendy pencil. And I love them because you can get a whole lot of values out of one pencil. So I'm kind of like I'm a fan of Blackwings, a fan girl, I guess. The value scale, which is what you're looking at in this picture, it's depicting what all of these different pencils can do. So if you look at the hard pencils, 6H, they actually go up to 9H, but 6H is the hardest in this scale, and it goes to HB. Those are all considered hard pencils. Hard pencils are exactly what they sound like. They're hard, so they make lighter lines. The higher the H number, the harder they get. HB is the softest of the hard pencils, and you can still see that you can get pretty dark with an HB. And then you go into soft pencils, which are the B pencils, and you can see B2B is probably very familiar for many of you, especially if you've gone to a public school in the 80s and 90s or taught in the school. 2B pencils are used on testing. So when you fill in the little bubbles, 2B is what they make you use, so that their scanners can read it. 8B is the softest pencil, and at that point, you're pretty much getting into charcoal territory. 6B is probably as dark as you'd need to get with graphite, and you can layer graphite on top of itself, and it will continue to get darker and darker and darker. The trick to layering graphite is that you don't dig into your paper, because you always want to protect the pulp of the paper, and you don't want ruts in the paper. So you can keep layering and layering and layering, getting darker and darker. However, you also don't have to, but if you want to keep layering, it'll keep getting darker, because on a magnified level, it looks like graphite is magnets. And so they kind of stick to each other. Each subsequent layer keeps sticking and building up, making that darker layer. So hard pencils, soft pencils, the difference between mainly, I use my hard pencils to build the scaffolding of my drawing because it's easy to erase and I can fix them. Amy asked what value is a mechanical pencil. Typically they're in the H's. Mechanical pencils are also scaffolding pencils. So they typically are probably looking at around a 2H to a 4H. Architects, when they were using pencils before digital, they were using hard pencils. So So that's pretty much hard and soft. A value scale is super important from light to dark. You can see 6H to 8B. There's a wide variation of lights and darks. If you want to have volume or depth or contrast in your drawing, you'll need to use a range of values. So not just one or two, or it'll just be a black and white drawing. Paper, there's all kinds of papers. So these are two that I've been using a lot. The Strathmore drawing paper, it comes in kind of an ivory color. It's really nice paper. This is a really fine paper. So it doesn't necessarily mean it's more or less expensive. It just means the quality of the paper itself is meant for detailed drawing. The mixed media is exactly what it sounds like. You can use different mediums on it. So I use wet mediums and dry mediums together on that blue pad of Canson paper. You have to decide kind of what materials are you using. If you're gonna use something that has water in it for drawing purposes, like watercolor is considered drawing, you would probably want to get something for mixed media. If you're only using graphite, you'll probably just want to get a drawing paper, not for mixed media. They come in different textures. There's fine texture, which is a very smooth paper. There's very heavily textured paper, so you can get bumps within it, and some people like that. And then tones of paper, meaning your paper could be anything from white to gray to green, browns, reds, anything. And then you can use dark values with your pencils. And then if you want to show light values on toned paper, you would use white chalk. So white chalk ends up being your highest highlights. And then I've got newsprint, which is great for padding your drawing board. And so a copy paper, the Cheatums are asking about copy paper. Copy paper is perfectly fine for drawing. Napkins are perfectly fine for drawing. Anything you have that's paper is going to be great for drawing. Envelopes. I have doodled many, many times on envelopes. Some of my favorite paintings, some of my favorite drawings I have seen on napkins. So I think Picasso was super famous for drawing on napkins. That's how he paid his bills. So paper tape I've got here in case any of you are looking for a setup at your house. Paper tape is usually blue or white. It's made specifically for artists. It's usually about $6 or $7 a roll. And it's meant to stay, hold your paper up. And when you peel it off, it's not going to peel off the fiber from the paper. So it just holds it in place so it doesn't move around. And you don't want to keep this on your paper any longer than 30 days. Otherwise, it will start embedding into the pulp itself. When you peel it off, you'll start getting tears. The fewer amount of days you can keep it up, the longer. Is it different from painter's tape? It is slightly different, although I am using painter's tape in addition just because I haven't been able to get my regular artist tape. So you can use painter's tape in a pinch. It's not quite as good, but similar enough. You could get away with it. I wouldn't keep it on probably any longer than a week at most. Okay, this is a photograph I took last night. This was behind me. This is an easel and a drawing board. This is how I draw. I draw vertical. The reason why I draw vertically is because there's less skewing with proportions. So if I'm drawing flat on a table and I want to get my proportions accurate, they're always going to be on a skewing bias. So I'm always going to have to keep correcting and correcting in order to get everything in proportion. So I like to draw vertical, and that way I can also walk away from my drawings. If my drawings are really bad, I'll walk very, very far away. But otherwise, I will keep them vertical, and then I can step back and see if there's anything that needs to be fixed. My easel is a cheapo wooden easel. You could get table easels. They're pretty, I think I've seen some for like $5 or $6 on Amazon. Drawing boards come in all different shapes and sizes. In a pinch, you can use a piece of cardboard. Anything that's rigid enough that can hold and is stable and an easel, and then your work can be taped in. You'll notice behind the drawing is kind of this like gray paper. That is newsprint, and that newsprint is about 2 or 3 layers of newsprint. And I'm just going to say a word about this. Usually I use newsprint for warm-ups and I use it for charcoal. However, very important for a drawing board. Drawing board is usually wood. It's usually very hard. So if you imagine what it's like when you take a test on a piece of paper and it's just a piece of paper on a wooden desk and you're writing on it with a pencil, that really dry, hard way that it feels, if you were to pat it on a stack of paper and then write with a pencil, it's going to feel very different. So I like to have padding, and it's not a science to it. You just kind of figure out what padding works well with your paper. Okay. Light perspective. This is some basic 101 lighting perspective. You're looking for what direction the light is angling at for your object. And most importantly, for any type of artwork, you want a separation of light and dark. So you can see the shadow line in there. There's a separation right in the middle of this sphere. The light is coming in from the upper left corner, the upper left side. And it says the center light. You've got a highlight there. The highlight is the highest light. On white paper, the highlight would just be white of the paper coming through. And then you've got halftone, which is starting to get a little bit darker toward the center, toward the where the beginning of the darkest shadow begins. And that's called the terminator line, or the termination line, also known as the bedbug line. I don't know why they call it that. I prefer the terminator. The terminator is where light can no longer go. So if you think of, like, this always reminds me of a planet. So when you look at planets and you see where their light is casting on them, there's a point at which you can't see the light anymore. And that point is the terminator. And behind the terminator, you get your reflected light, you get a core shadow. And then anything that light, when an object is when light is shining on an object and that object blocks the light, it creates a shadow. That is called a cast shadow. The shadow is being cast from the object where light can no longer get through. So those are the main points of light perspective on a sphere. And then this is my super secret trick before we get going. Instead of drawing curves, because none of us can really draw a good circle, it's really difficult to do. So what classical schools do, and ateliers, classical art schools, they draw straight, short lines, and they avoid curves altogether, because you'll get more accuracy out of really straight, short lines. Unless, of course, you're drawing a contour line, which, if any of you are figure drawers, you draw contour lines, which is a long expressive line, and that might have a curve in it. But if you're drawing anything that's technical, or you're drawing something and you want to get it really specific, short, straight lines are your answer. You're going to see me do a little bit of those today. Okay, strong photo references. What do those mean? Clear separation of light and shadow and good composition. These are simple compositions. This is a simple still life, meaning it's only one object. A complex still life means there's more than one object. That's the vocabulary of them. They're both beautiful pairs. The one on the left is going to be much more difficult to draw because there's not a whole lot of variation in values. So the one on the right, you can see a separation of shadow, midtones, and highlight. So I'm going to talk today about the grid. There's several different ways that you can engage with drawing. The grid is one of them. And grids are probably one of the oldest forms of drawing. They come from ancient Egypt, and they continued for 2,000 years under the Roman period. We still use them today. If you've ever seen Renaissance artwork, which many of you, all of you probably have, most of those artists were using the grid in some form. Grids are not always little squares. Sometimes they're triangles or diamonds, or they do all kinds of weird, fun grids. There's a whole long history of them. It's a really easy way to get into drawing. These are my third week introduction to drawing students' artwork. So when I teach introduction to drawing at Glasscock, the first 2 days are spent pretty much on value scales, and our third week is spent on the grid. And so people who have never picked up a pencil, this is the quality of work they commonly get using a grid system. So the number one rule of using a grid is taking your time. That's all there, that's the trick, take your time. Okay, so if they can do it, you guys can do it, because if you're, especially if you're a beginning artist, and if you're not a beginning artist, you definitely can do this. Okay, so this is what we're gonna do today. I've got a photograph for us. One of the things that you can do early on while you're starting drawing, I highly recommend doing this, take a good photo, something that's well lit, showing highlights and shadows. Take the photo of it with your phone or whatever you're going to take, a tablet, whatever, and then transfer the photo into grayscale or black and white. They have filters for it. You just tap on a filter and there it is. And then you'll be able to easily see where that line, that separation line is between light and shadow. Okay, so this grid is kind of funky because I had to do it in an app on my phone, and I just, and even with the paid version of the app, it's not perfect. It's called the Grid or Grid app, and it gridded it out for me. And I grid with centimeters. Since nobody can talk back to me right now because everyone's on mute, I'm just going to go ahead and say it. Centimeters are superior. That's all. I just want to say that. There's only two countries in the world that don't use, you know, centimeters, and we're one of them. So This is strangely 1.7 centimeters, which is a lot less complicated than its equivalent in our regular measuring in inches. So 1.7 centimeters across, and I'm going to enlarge this grid for the demo that I'm giving you today because I wanted you to be able to see it. I didn't want it to be so tiny. You'll notice I put numbers down one side, letters across the top, and that's just to make it easier for me to find things on the grid. Okay, so this is an example of what I was doing last night when I organized this grid. I doubled it. I'm going to zoom in here. That's the extent of my mathing right there. So for all you math people out there, I just mathed last night. It's very exciting for me. So I doubled the 1.7 centimeters. We now have 3.4 centimeters. That'd be really embarrassing if I got that wrong. And then I measured out 3.4 centimeters for all the squares going across to get the equivalent of what the grid was for that pair that I showed you. It's double the amount. Now you'll notice this is not perfect. If I was doing a super technical drawing that was really important, I would be very, very careful and I would take my time measuring it. However, for a demo and for something kind of quick, I'm just going to slap this together. If you have a ruler, feel free to do 3.4 centimeters, feel free to do inches, it doesn't matter. So you just make sure that you have one, two, three, four, five rows. And that fifth row is really not even like a whole row. It's kind of like two-thirds of a row. So you can go ahead and do that across. So that's one, two, three, four, five down, and one, two, three, four across. That fifth row, I just kind of canceled out. So if you want to go ahead and do that real quick, well, I move over to the other camera, you can. By the way, I'll just show you this too. I taped out my grid just so it's easier for me to see. And this is what we're going to be working on today. One other note, while you're doing this, I'm going to talk as you're gridding. One way to look at these grids, sometimes these squares can be very large. And one easy way to handle that is to subdivide your squares. So instead of one big square, you can do halves. So I have little green lines where I would, like, that's the 50% mark of the square. And then the little blue lines are 25 and 25. So that way I kind of quarter, in my mind, I quarter the squares. So that way I can make them smaller if I need to. Okay. I'm gonna look up here and just see if anybody has any other questions while we're doing this. If you have any questions, send them over because we're getting ready to rock and roll. Okay, I'm gonna leave that up there and I'm gonna give you a minute or two just to get your grid ready. And then I'm gonna switch over to this other camera. And if you're, whenever you're ready, I'm going to be at that other camera. You should be able to see a camera that has, I'm going to leave the pairs up because that's what you're going to draw from. And then you're going to see my hand waving in the blue tape over the grid. So you can scroll through if you have a whole bunch of little people at the bottom of your screen or wherever people are. Just scroll through until you find my hand. So that way you can see both the pair. You should be able to toggle back and forth between the pair and my hand. Oh, say that one more time. Oh, okay, great. Great. Okay. So hopefully everybody can see the pair and they can also see my blue tape. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to start, I'm going to take a hard pencil. The hardest one I have I'm using is a B. The reason why I'm using a B, I'm going to put this up here. The reason I'm using a B, I guess it goes this way, is because I want you to be able to see what I'm doing. If I was doing this on my own, I would probably start with a 2H just to make sure. So you can see on my grid, I put A, B, C, D across the top and the bottom. and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 on the left and the right side. And that's so I can keep track of it. Now, this is really rudimentary because it's just like the beginning, very basic, so you understand how to do a grid. But if you did something super complex, this is also another really good system to use, because you can use the entire alphabet. And then when you get to the end of the alphabet, if you still have more squares, you can start using A, A, B, B, C, C, and so on and so forth. Okay. And then it's just helpful. You can also cover up areas that you don't want. I don't have an extra piece of paper, but I'll show you what I mean with my gross rag, which is while you're working on one area, if you don't want to get confused, you can cover the rest of the stuff that you're not using, or actually cover just one square, leave one square open as you work it. You don't need to use the entire exposed grid. Okay, so I'm counting over 1, 2, 3. C is where my pair starts. And my pair is starting about a quarter down, and I'm gonna make a little notation here. And then it kind of comes down here. I'm looking at the stem, and I just kind of want to figure out where this stem ends. It ends about 50%, maybe a little bit further over this way, 50% over my eraser. So that's kind of my aim, is I've got from this part of the stem here, and it comes over to about right there, and I'm going to match these up. I'm just going to kind of connect the dots. And I'm not drawing in another, let's see, make a little line. I'm not drawing out of my grid line. I'm staying within one thing and staying focused here. And this line kind of swings over, it curves over a little bit. So now that I have my main information in here, I can kind of start putting a little bit more information in. That's about all I'm going to do. I'm not going to clean it up just yet, because I want to add in the next square. So I'm going to go down to the top of the pair. It's about right here. And this has kind of a straight line across. I'm looking at really simple shapes. This end, this line ends about, maybe about a little bit lower than 50%. And I'm going to make a little straight line there. And then this guy comes straight down. And by the way, I talk while I draw because I'm not insane, but it helps me focus. If I can focus my words, my eyes will also focus. Okay, so I think that's a little bit, this needs a little bit more of a diagonal there. Okay, now I'm getting ready to go into my next line. I'm going to go into D2 over here. You guys can go wherever you want to go. Okay, so that's kind of where that is. This kind of has a little bump and then comes up. I'm going to fix that, because I'm seeing it. Okay, and now I'm gonna kind of come down, where's my landing point in this on B2? My landing point is about 50% over. So I'm gonna, and it's got a little wobble in it, but I'm not gonna worry about that too much. I just wanna kind of get to my landing point. There's that. And then my next landing point is almost one quarter up on 3B. Kind of like doing a puzzle or something. Okay, and it's just going to hit that corner right through 3A. And then 4B, it's coming, it ends about a quarter the way there, and it's just kind of a sliver. Okay, and now I haven't even looked at my overall image just yet. I'm just kind of following through. All right, so now I'm going to come back up here. I have this. This kind of comes to about a quarter, if I had to guess, probably around right there. And then it kind of swings out. This is a little bit further than 50%. So I know I need to hit this and hit this. Okay, so I'm hitting my marks over there. This is going to swing out again on 4D. This kind of swings out about there. So I'm just going to kind of get that. And then it swings back in. About right there. And this is about a quarter down going into D5. That's not totally right. think I'm going to straighten. Now I've got this in here, I'm going to just kind of straighten out that line, fix it a little bit. Okay. And then this is getting into a shadow. So I'm just following one thing at a time. I'm looking at the edge lines and I'm kind of making little marks and then I'm connecting my dots. So it, oftentimes if it feels like it's too easy to be correct, that's exactly what art making is. So, and it's like a puzzle. You're solving a puzzle the whole time. Okay, so now I kind of have the general shape of my hair. The next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to look for a separation of shadow and light. And the easiest way to do this is squint. So if I squint at my hair, I can tell that 2B is the main part of my shadow area. And I'm going to just kind of mark out, do a little line. That's the next thing I'm doing, is figuring out where my shadow is. Okay. So yours is already a mess. Do you need to go back and just double check your lines? See where your lines are at? I'm going to pull this out a little bit. I think my 3B is a little bit too thin. I need to make that a little bit wider. And I'm just going to leave that mark because this starts my shadow. So now it looks like I have a massive amount of shadow in 4A and B. And I'm just going to start blocking out that shadow area. And if you're thinking, okay, and then down at the bottom here, this kind of starts up at 5 and then goes down this end part here. All right, I'm just going to get this in. And then I can throw in the cast shadow. Remember, we talked about cast shadow because my light is coming from up here. So my cast shadow is going to come out, swing down. It's about right here. It's a little bit more like 50%. There it is. And then this ends about, where does that go to? About there. And then this is about, I'm looking at the full line, not from the pare down. So from the full line, it comes down a little bit further than 50% down here. And then it doesn't, let's see, it's less than half, and it's on an angle. So there's my short straight line, kind of making it correct. Okay, so that's a really messy shadow. I can straighten that up now. Okay, so I pretty much have my main shadows in there. So now what I can do is I can go to a darker value. And again, this is a really quick, oh, I need to put my shadow in up here too. So this, I can work inside the grid by measuring 25, 50%, whatever I need, off from the left side over for this shadow, the left side of this stem. And then, let's see, about here it kind of gets a little bit lighter. Okay, so now there are other shadows in this, but I'm gonna go ahead and, let's see. Okay, you got the, hopefully you found the pairs. Okay, so now I'm gonna go in and I'm just gonna shade in my shadow. And I'm gonna do this with cross-hatching. Well, I'm gonna use hatching. Hatching, I'm gonna do a little demo up here, is little lines that are right next to each other. So this is hatching. Cross-hatching, you can go at an angle, and then it's kind of this waffle pattern. The closer your hatches are to one another, the darker the value is. The further away they are, the lighter the value is. So I'm going to go ahead and hatch in here. And your hatches can follow the shape of your pear. It's a fast way to get in shading. And then I'm going to throw in some shadow down here too. And for those of you who are new to drawing, I want to let you know that I might make some of this stuff look really, really easy, but I've been doing it for a very, very long time. So I oftentimes remind people, how long did it take for you to get really good at your job? I still don't think I'm really good at mine. I'm still working on it. It's a process. But it gets better the more you practice. All right, so now I'm just gonna keep, I'm gonna shade this in. I'm gonna get a darker pencil, a softer pencil, so you can see what that does. I'm gonna get a 6B. Since this is the occlusion shadow, which is the point where the object touches the surface, it's usually the darkest part. And then I'm gonna kind of swing out into the cast shadow. So you got, let's see, I'm looking at questions real quick. Okay, so your pencil's horrible. What kind of pencil should I get? Number two pencil is probably good. It's a 2B. You can do a lot with a 2B pencil. It doesn't need to be a fancy pencil. Mine are fancy pencils because that's what I got. But I use unfancy pencils too. Okay, now I'm gonna put in this shadow up here. And I'm just going to color this in. So I've got different mark making going on. I can give it a little bit of an outline. And I'll just fill this in. This is not, I think it'd probably be really helpful at this point for me to know kind of where the highest highlights are. So I'm gonna go in and just kind of indicate where my highest highlights are. There's one here, there's one here. So that way I'm kind of always got one eye on where the separation of light and shadow are. So that's kind of where my light and shadow are separating. Okay, and then this kind of gets a little bit darker in here. So I'm gonna start breaking apart where the light and shadow are. Located. This is a little bit darker. It's not quite as dark as my shadow, but it's a little bit darker. So on my value scale, I can go a little darker. And I can start blending it in with the value beside it just by gently covering over it. Okay, and then this kind of comes back over. Is everyone hanging in there? I'm gonna go down here. This is a darker shadow right here. So this is kind of the main body of this pair. And I'm gonna throw in a little bit darker shadow. And notice I'm not holding my pencil like you would hold your pencil to like write or take a test. I'm holding it pretty loose and I'm using all angles of it. I'm using the side of it, both sides of it. This looks like it has some darker values going on over here. And I'm starting to correct. So now I'm starting to look at the overall pair. I'm coming out of the world of grid and I'm starting to cover over my grid. This is much darker. So I can just keep on layering. If you have a harder pencil, that's okay, you can just keep on layering. And just take your time with it. I just told one of my students yesterday that there is no prize for rushing. There are no prizes for rushing. I'm gonna erase some of this out. This is a little bit too dark, so I need to lighten this value a little bit. And then I'm gonna grab, let's see, I'm staying with my B pencil, which is a little bit harder than a 2B. And I'm going to go over that highlighted area just a little bit. So you can see the pair is starting to form. It's kind of a sloppy pair, but it's a pair nonetheless. How's my time doing?
You're doing good. We can just, you know, we'll go, since I don't expect a large Q&A, we've been answering questions as we go, we can afford to go a few more minutes here.
Good, okay, perfect. All right, so I'm gonna get in here with my, let's see what my black wing does. It's a little bit darker graphite. And I have in here, by the way, I didn't mention, if you tend to drag your hands across your drawing, you can put a piece of paper under your hand and like move it along. So that way the oils in your hand don't smear your drawing. I'm just gonna go ahead and darken this area a little bit. All right, and I can see that I need to get this much darker. One thing I haven't tried yet is I've got this thing that's a paper stump or a tortillon, however they pronounce it. And I want to, I think I'm going to use some of that blending to blend. And then there's some personality to this pear, but I don't want to get involved with the actual flesh of the pear because it just starts getting confusing. I want to stick mainly with just shadows and highlights. Does anyone have any questions on the grid itself? Is everyone understanding the approach of the grid? Try this tortillon. So this is a piece of paper that's twirled really, really tightly. And I can go in and just blend. This is instead of using my finger to blend. And this just kind of softens edges. Sometimes it's nice to soften them up a little bit. I can see I need to go in and take out some of the graphite, because it's a little bit dark in some areas. So by the way, this is a very super, super fast drawing for me. This is probably something that I would typically spend a couple of hours on. So this is a like expedited drawing. So by the way, you do have somebody in your group who's a really excellent draftsperson, which is Ken Ismert. Give a little shout out to Ken. I don't know if he's here today or not. But if you have questions, direct them all to Ken. He will know how to fix your drawing. I'm gonna go in and take out some of this. So I'm using my kneadable eraser. This is a really gross one because I've been using it a lot and it's just gum. It's like gum, but it's just a really kind of movable, kneadable eraser. And it just helps pick up extra, extra either charcoal or in this case, graphite. Hey, Terry. Terry, is Ken with you today? Oh, yay. Okay, good. I think we should all take a look at Ken's drawing when we're done with this. Put him on the spot. Okay, so this is starting to get, and I think my darks can go a little bit darker, but it's starting to take a little bit more shape. Now, what to do with the rest of this grid when you're done, you can go through, if you measured out your grid with a hard pencil, it'll be very easy to get rid of any of the extra lines that you don't want. Some people like to keep the grid in because they like to show their work. I personally really love seeing grids in drawings or partial grids, it kind of gives a little bit of the process away. And I enjoy seeing the process. I like, it's kind of like you get to see how people's brains work. And you get to see a cool drawing too, hopefully. So I kind of dig it. Okay, so there's that. And then I kind of have an option. I can, if I wanted to, go back in, and this is kind of like the decorative part. My dark areas are not quite as dark as I want them. I can really go in and, so I'm gonna kind of darken some of the darks. I'm using my Blackwing pencil, by the way. Okay, to darken. Okay, so now I have an option. I can go back in. Okay, I got two or three more minutes. I can go back in if I wanted to in the background here. And wherever there's dark, if you have light, it helps push it forward. In this area where I've got a lot of light, I can have the option. This might totally screw up my drawing. I don't think it will. I can go in here and give it some dark, and that'll help bring it forward in space. Because it's all about contrast, all about values. And I don't have to fill in the entire thing. I can just give it like a hint of dark. And it gives a little bit of energy to it because there's some, you know, you can see some handwork in it. And so I think that's probably, I'll go one more little pass with this kneadable eraser to pull out highlights. One last time in here. And I think in here, I could probably lighten this a little bit because now I can make changes based on what my eye sees in my drawing because nobody's gonna be looking at the pear in the photo. When they look at my drawing, they're gonna be looking at my drawing. So my drawing now has to be kind of, it has to make sense and it has to be visually interesting to look at. There it is. So this is a grid drawing. Hopefully that helps. Does it look like a pear? Hopefully. Here. Okay. Does anyone have any questions?
All right. Well, I hope everybody's pair looks good. Here's what we're going to do, guys. Actually, this will be great fun. We're going to take about a 10-minute break, and we're going to give you an opportunity to go out in your breakout rooms. And what I want you to do in your breakout rooms is obviously say hi to everybody in your breakout room and show them your pair drawings, and let's all share our pairs. And then we're going to come back after our short break. We may have time for one or two little questions, and then we'll wrap it up. So with that, let's take some time to share our pairs in our breakout rooms. And Abhishek, you can go ahead and kick those off. Everybody's pair came in, so I wanted to share my drawing. It's a guy holding a pear. Yum. No, I'm just kidding. This was my pear, and Scott's going to show his pear.
Well, I attempted the shading at the
back. Oh, that looks great. Wait, hold it up again.
All right. You caught on to me. Hold yours up too.
His pear. Oh, no, his pear looks way better than mine.
No. So this was really fun, by the way. We really enjoyed doing this.
This was super, super fun. So let's see here. We literally have just a few seconds, and Scott and I are taking it up with our narcissism and showing off our pairs. Does anybody have any questions or quick comments or want to show off their pair? Let's go over to Anita.
That's my zebra.
Anita says she drew a zebra instead of a pear, and it actually looks really good. So
can I post my zebra?
Yeah, go for it.
Yes.
Zebras are welcome. Other comments or questions for Laura, or does anybody want to show off their art? Uh-oh, I see some bashful people. Not many hands up. Okay, hold on. Rebecca and John, I'm gonna go and show John's holding up his pear. That's excellent.
Wow, that's heck beautiful. Yeah.
Awesome job. We're getting lots of jazz hands for that pear. Cool, guys.
I'm so impressed.
This was a lot of fun, Laura. We really appreciate you coming out and guiding us through this. And is there anything you kind of want to say in closing? Well, I guess laurasspector.com is one of the ways we can check out some of your work.
Yeah, laurasspector.com. Join me. I do intro to drawing classes. All my classes are going to be on Zoom, and they're all throughout the day and night. They're all different times. I also do painting classes. I got a painting video on my, a series that you can do at your own pace. And also, I've got a drawing class coming up for those of you who are a little bit more experienced, a wet and dry charcoal portrait drawing class coming up at WASH Watercolor Art Society starts next week. So please join me. Somebody asked how much classes cost. They range. Some of them start around like 150 and then some go up to around 350. Just depends on the length of them, how many weeks. I try and do like painting classes typically go like 8 or 9 weeks if possible. So yeah. Well, that's anybody else have any other questions for me?
A great way to keep.
I hope you all keep drawing. So if you liked it, just keep going. You don't have to, you know, be a master at it. It's, you know, just try it and keep practicing because it's very relaxing and it's good for your brain.
It's good to take care of yourself. That was one of my takeaways. I felt this almost like meditative state while I was drawing, like very relaxing. I don't know if anybody else experienced that. Really nice. And Samia wants to say something. Go for it, Samia.
Hi there. Thank you so much. That was so enjoyable. The question I have is, how do you know whether your lines ought to be vertical or horizontal? Or, I mean, in my drawing, which is at a grade of kindergarten, how do you know whether your line should go vertically or horizontally, not the piece itself, but your shadows?
The shadows?
Right.
Usually I'll try and kind of follow the shape of the object that I'm working on. However, there is an exception. When you go to draw like hair, for example, most people draw hair like up and down. If people have straight hair, it's like up and down. But I've found that if you go side to side, it creates volume. So it's kind of a trick of the eye. There are little tricks that you pick up here and there. And the only way you do it is just from practicing, experimenting with it.
Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely.
Very cool. Right, any other last minute comments or questions? Looks like I don't see anybody in the grids. Well, again, thank you very much to Laura Spector, and thanks everybody for drawing along. This happens every week because we have amazing speakers that come like Laura, and we have everybody that shows up. It also happens because of your donations. And so if you are interested in supporting Houston Oasis and the mission of creating secular community here in the Houston area, I will be posting some links in the comments. and you can sign up there and become a recurring donor if you'd like as well. With that, though, we're excited to welcome back the musicians that we welcomed at the top of our program before all of our pair drawing. Let's welcome back David Dietz and Nikki Sohn.
Hi, thank you very much. We're going to finish up today with one final little song, going back into more classical stuff. And so we're going to play a little song called The Swan by the 19th century French composer Camille Saint-Saëns.
Thank you again, guys, David Dietz and Nikki Sohn. Thank you. Well, I thought today's gathering was very appealing. And you?
I'm sorry, guys.
What did you think? Anyway, Okay. Listen, this was a lot of fun. We were glad to have Laura. I don't know how to come back from that. We were glad to have Laura Spector here. We were glad to have David Dietz. If you enjoyed the gathering here, be back here next week. We're going to have Paige Powell from Air Alliance Houston talking about clean air and healthy future here in Houston. And tonight at 8 o'clock, you can also join us in a Zoom style gathering or on Facebook Live for the 21st edition of the Coronavirus Conversation with Dr. Richard Andrews and Dr. Will Judy. And so there's going to be a lot of information about Corona, obviously, here in Harris County. It's a good way to find out the latest. And we'll have some information about that on our website and on Facebook. Thanks, everybody, for coming out. We loved your drawings, and we'll see everybody next week. Bye, guys. Okay. We